Gentlemen, you know, I think this is a historical moment of sorts. You know, on the one hand, right here, seated here, are arguably two of the most successful, the most successful filmmaker duo in Hollywood, Anthony and Joe Russo, the men that gave us two of the highest grossing films of all time, Avengers Endgame and, of course, Avengers Infinity War. And then joining us virtually from his home in Hyderabad is arguably the most successful filmmaker across India, Mr. S.S. Rajamouli, whose last two films, RRR and Bahubali 2, shattered box office records for Indian films worldwide. So forgive me for being very excited today.
We're very excited as well, by the way. Raja, such a pleasure to meet you. We're huge fans.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Anthony. So nice to meet you.
Lovely. Gentlemen, I thought I'd start by asking you, what is the trick to telling stories that transcend boundaries? I feel like Hollywood has done that successfully over the years. Your films travel beyond just English-speaking boundaries. What is the trick to telling a story to a global audience? And is that something that weighs in when you're writing?
I think it does weigh in for us anyway. What we tend to do is think about things on a global level. That's sort of think about what kind of experiences that we're having on a global level, and that people around the world are also sharing in. What kind of anxieties? What kind of excitements? Those kinds of things. And it's a layer of the storytelling. It helps us connect into like how people are feeling and thinking collectively on a global level, as opposed to a more local level.
We look for universal truths, and I think it is a primary goal of ours, and in fact, I would say the primary goal, to use storytelling as a binding element to bring people together. That's why we have a global perspective. We're very fortunate to have worked all over the world,
right,
to talk to fan bases all over the world. So I think that over time, we've had a more sophisticated understanding of the way audiences think, and it without question informs our storytelling and the way that we construct stories.
You know, Mr. Rajamouli, I'd love for you to weigh in. In your last two films, in Bahubali and in RRR, you actually told stories that were intrinsically Indian stories. They're rooted in mythology, they're rooted in Indian history, and yet these were films that spoke to a much larger audience than typically Indian cinema tends to reach out to. What do you attribute that to?
Basically, I believe like a good story is a good story for all the people across the globe, whichever country they are in. But to take a story to cross the boundaries, to cross cultures, there are many, many hurdles. But I think the principal hurdle is belief. Principally, if I don't believe that I have a good enough story that transcends boundaries, then there is no way I can make the other audiences believe that I have that story. So I think principally it is a belief. If we have that, the other hurdles can be crossed.
So you don't tailor your stories to speak to a global audience specifically?
No. Basically, like I was saying, an emotion is the same. A relationship between husband and wife, a father and son, two friends, whatever it is the same as in America, as in India, as in Japan. You know, it is the same. It doesn't change. But how we tell that emotion changes, the nuances will change, but the core emotion remains the same. But the way, if I don't tell my story, the way I envision it, and I keep thinking about what others are going to envision, then I think I'm not doing a justice for both the people.
Right. Well said. You know, what all three of you have in common is that you tend to dazzle us with the scale of your filmmaking. Clearly, y'all are not interested in small, intimate stories. I want to ask all of you, how do you ensure that the drama, the emotion, the humor, if you like, doesn't get weighed down by the spectacle?
You have to track it through character, and I think that's something that Raja does very well, especially in RRR. This is a very profoundly emotional story. Spectacle is a backdrop and a vehicle by which that story is told. but at the center of it is a profoundly emotional story of brotherhood. And I think, you know, that's an essential, as he said a moment ago, that's essential mythology that can translate to any culture around the world. The same is true for the work we do, as we try to find that, you know, that essential theme that's important to us, put the characters on that theme so that we have a spine, and then you build the spectacle around the goals of the characters. And if it's you're leading with spectacle, then you'll get lost. But if you're leading with what the characters want, what their desires are, what they're trying to accomplish, what they'll sacrifice their lives for, I think that is when you can the spectacle can service that emotional story rather than the reverse.
Mr. Rajamouli, do you agree with that?
Yes, a lot. But I have please don't put them and me on the same platform. They have had a mountain of success. I still have a small mound of success. So don't put us on the same platform. But I think yes, I really agree with Joe on that aspect. And for me, I mean, it's a dazzling spectacle. We love to do that. I love to do that. But the base of it, there needs to be an emotion that drives. The emotion is the basement on which we can build this huge spectacle. If that emotional engagement is not there, then how much ever big spectacle you give, the audiences will not be interested in.
You know, the other thing, of course, that you share in common is this love for action, whether disguised as big superhero films or, in the case of The Gray Man, a spy story. What you're doing is mounting these robust action films. It's true of you, Mr. Rajamouli, as well. You're clearly, action is clearly a genre you enjoy working in. Does action tend to travel wider than other genres?
Yeah, it certainly does for me. I mean, if there is a beautiful love story on one side and there is a medium kind of action film, both as an option, which I have to say, I'll first go for the action film. Okay. So it really, I am a huge action buff. So I tend to think the whole audience are like me. So yes, that's a big penchant for action film.
Yeah. Action is a universal language, you know, and it's about geography, choreography. It can be told without words. So I do think in a lot of ways that it's the most transcendent genre, the one that, the most universal genre, the one that most everyone in the world can follow. We all understand action and movement.
I think you've seen that over, you know, in the past decade or so, there's been a large movement in terms of the global audience.
Yeah.
Largely due to the internet and the connection we all have now through the internet and social media, and the fact that we can communicate with one another about films together, that's created more of a global audience and a global sensibility. And I think you've seen over the past decade, action films have become more popular, and sort of things like comedy, sometimes things that are specific to like cultural sensitivities or understandings, they haven't sort of been as, at least in the Hollywood realm, they haven't sort of been as popular as they once were. And I think that speaks to the fact that action is a language that connects the global audience in a strong way.
You know, I think that generally when it comes to action, it tends to be about masculinity. They're usually about the male characters that get to have all the fun, so to speak. I know that that's not... You have, of course, in the Avengers, for example, you've had some great female superheroes that have kicked ass, so to speak. And it's true of The Gray Man as well. You have Ana de Armas, who's excellent, you know, doing her stunts. And Mr. Rajamouli, I know that in Bahubali, at least, you had Tamanna's character in the first film that was this rebel warrior, and she does get to do her fair share of action. But would either of you be interested in, you know, would you be drawn ever, you think, to a female-led action film?
Absolutely. I think, you know, it's a... let's take Anna's character, for instance. Strong, independent, you know, not romantically linked to the lead character, has her own agenda and motivation, and in fact, continually saves Ryan Gosling's character throughout the movie to the point where it becomes a comedic runner that she is, in a lot of ways, more competent than he is, or certainly more aggressive in making sure that they both get out of situations safely. We love strong, confident characters, irrespective of gender. I think the world loves all stories. And no matter what story you tell, if you tell it well and you tell it truthfully, they're going to support it. And there's plenty of room for movies about strong female characters.
Yeah. Well, I would also say that it's our job as storytellers to bring new experiences to audiences. You know, that's there's nothing better that we can do other than bring a version of a narrative to an audience that they haven't seen before. And certainly... there's a lot of room to do innovative work with female characters because of the relative lack of the imbalance that's existed up till this point.
Of course. Mr. Rajamouli?
I would really love to do, not just in terms of action, but a really strong female lead leading the whole story. There are a couple of storylines that are running in my mind. We are discussing that. But like any film, at the end of, I don't think too many films at a time. At the end of one film, I'll just look at what are the exciting ideas that are around me, and I pick up the most exciting one at that point of time and go forward. If it's a hero film, it's a hero film. It's a heroine film, it's a heroine film.
You don't overthink it then. I want to ask you, Mr. Rajamouli, the best action sequences are usually sort of hinged on a unique idea. I'm going to discuss one from RRR. It is, of course, that sequence in which Junior NTR's character Bheem crashes that celebration with that truck, and he releases dozens of wild animals, including tigers, that wreak havoc at this celebration. How do you come up with something like that?
I like some crazy ideas, definitely. And it also has a little bit work on his character. He's a tribal. Then as we are working it, we see what are his strengths. Being a man, tribal man, being living in the jungle, he will have lots of ways to do with the animals. So that kind of thinking, if he's going into a place which is not his strength, so obviously he will garner his strengths and go. So what are his strengths? Animals can be a thing. Now, so that kind of thinking will lead me to that. But apart from that, I really, really like to surprise and awe the people to the maximum.
It's quite evident in your films. For the Russos, I think certainly where The Gray Man is concerned, it's got to be that sequence in the city square in Prague, which is, again, a great idea because you've got a target that's actually handcuffed to a bench, and there's bullets and there's blasts and there's a SWAT team, and they can't take him out. And then, of course, it culminates in that extraordinary tram sequence. I want to be your shrink for a moment, play along. Can I link, the kind of action that you do to the eight-year-old in you that just enjoyed blowing things up?
Probably.
Perhaps. Although we were a bit more... we were a bit more academic when we were kids. Okay. We were sort of, we weren't making movies, we weren't trying to make movies. We were more like just film geeks enjoying uh-huh. movies. But certainly we grew up with a bit of a punk rock attitude toward the world. And I think that sort of tearing things up is sort of certainly appealing to us on some level.
We're maximalists. Yeah. I mean, we're entertained by excess. We love scale, like ambition. This was always meant to be a relentless action exercise. Yeah. So, the sort of essential character elements pushing the film, but driven by action. Like the kind of movie that from frame one, it doesn't let you go till it's over. So that was the intent here. And, it's what we admired about the novel was how inventive and big and relentless it was in terms of action.
Mr. Rajamouli, can I ask you the same question? Is the love for action linked to some sort of childhood fascination for blowing stuff up?
I don't know. From child, as young as I can remember, I loved action, whether it's in the comic books, cartoons, or Western films, or novels, whatever. Action really, really caught up with me. I really love action films. But I want to ask Joe and Anthony on that. I was just reading in The Gray Man, they had 9 action set pieces. Okay, that's fine. But they shot that within a space of 5 months. They started in March and finished in July.
I think we're done in July. Yeah. Yeah.
How can you do that? I mean, the trailer shows what kind of action that we are going to witness. In fact, one of the things that I hated with the interview is I had to stop the film in between and come to this. I just started and I had to come to this. In the trailer, that it was like so much of action, and how could you do it in 5 months? Like, are you directing 2 separate units?
Great level of collaborators that we work with. We do run multiple units. Our second unit, so I think we shot for 95 days, and our second unit shot for 95 days, and we had a third unit that shot for about 40 days. So we do run multiple units because we have a very big crew that we have worked with for the better part of a decade now that has done all the Marvel movies with us. We're in a mind meld with each other. We have a common language about what we're trying to accomplish, and it is it's a military operation running a film crew. And so, fortunate enough to have the budget to support the scale of crew that we need in order to pull this off in a way that it doesn't take a year and a half to shoot it.
I think we also we've always spent a long time preparing. You know, we spend many, many months preparing, as you may do. Because we were shooting this movie during the pandemic, and we knew that once we got to production, things were going to be even more complicated than they normally are, and perhaps be more challenging than they normally are. I think we prepared even more thoroughly so that, you know, we could overcome the complications. So that might have been also a help in terms of accomplishing it.
Great to know, but that must be one hell of a team that you had.
They're very good. For sure. Yeah.
You know, Mr. Rajamouli, while we're on the subject, you know, I think you'll agree with me that, in Indian films often get, and I know that it's critics like myself who've done that as well, you'll see a great action scene and you'll say it's great by Indian standards. And there's always a comparison being made to the Avengers or to, you know, one of the big American tentpole films. I want to ask you do you feel like, and I do feel actually that RRR and Bahubali have changed that narrative to some degree because they do really hold up to the highest standards. But I want to ask you, is budget usually the only reason that maybe some of our best action sequences do not look as big as they would, as maybe the American films that we see?
No, budget is definitely a reason, but it's not the first reason. If you have the intent of really going big and you have, like they were saying, if you have a great team to support, those are the first principle things. You should have the intent, you should have a team, you should have a vision, and then comes the budget. And most of the time, if you have the first three, the budget will somehow come in and support. Like the kind of action sequences that we did for Bahubali was like, the first is like in 150 crores, which is like peanuts for the kind of budget for the action that we did.
To the Russos, you've made these big box office blockbusters for the studios. Why was Netflix the right home for The Gray Man?
Look, Joe and I, in conceiving The Gray Man and wanting to make it, we did want to construct a film that was extremely ambitious on an action level, and that was the experience for the lead characters and for the audience would be that of just running a gauntlet from the beginning of the movie to the end of the movie. So I think the scope of it, Netflix was in a period of great growth, and they were wanting to be very ambitious in terms of what they could accomplish as a studio, and they just wanted to support the film in the most strong way, and that's really why it felt right with Netflix. It just seemed to the ambition of the movie seemed to line up with their appetite for what they wanted to do as a studio, and they've been perfect partners. We already had a working relationship with them. We've produced several movies with Netflix up to this point, and we have a very strong, easy, successful partnership with them established. So once we knew that they had the appetite for a movie like this, that's where it all clicked.
Mr. Rajamouli, I think it's fair to say that after a very successful theatrical run, RRR was practically sort of rediscovered when it streamed on Netflix. The American critics discovered it. It became this critics' darling. A whole new audience sort of found out about RRR. There's some very serious talk of Oscar potential. Were you surprised by just how much attention the film was getting after it began streaming?
Yeah, there are two questions in your question. One thing is like, first of all, I'm actually angry with Netflix because they took only the Hindi version, not the rest of the four. So that is, I had a complaint against them. Second thing is, yes, I was surprised with the reception from the West. Like we were discussing before, a good story is a good story for everyone. But I didn't think I could make films for Western sensibilities. I never believed myself. So when it came out on Netflix and the people started watching it and the word of mouth started spreading, when the critics started giving out a good reviews for that, yes, I was really, really surprised. And yes, it wouldn't have been possible without Netflix. For that, I have great regard for them.
Have the two of you seen anything off RRR? Have you seen?
Well, I've seen RRR. Oh. It's amazing. It's incredible. I mean, I think what's so amazing about it is the level of emotion that it evokes combined with the spectacle. And I would say that, we have found that one of the advantages of digital distribution, we seem to be in a position where we're always defending an agnostic approach to filmmaking, because we see value in all levels of distribution, whether it be theatrical or digital. But digital has endorsed and allowed for more diversity than Hollywood has. And I would say in 5 years, it's probably done more for diversity and access to diverse and international films than Hollywood has done in 50 years. I think that's critically important. And I think that it's broken down barriers for, for people to, on a popular level, to watch films that are subtitled. It's been a long time, I think, since... I can't remember when theatrically it was a popular concept to watch films with subtitles. So I think there's a real value in that. And I think when you're talking about RRR finding a new audience via digital distribution, that is a primary example of the value of it. A show like Squid Games would never have worked in any other format than through digital distribution. And it became an international phenomenon. So I think audiences are getting a window now into true Indian cinema, true Korean filmmaking in ways that are very valuable and I think going to inform and inspire a new generation of filmmakers all over the world. And where, they're going to be taking elements from all of their favorite movies from every region and their favorite stories and combining them in a way that I think will be very unique and very fresh.
Has the idea of what a film is, has that been redefined? Because all of you really make these big, epic cinematic experiences, which I think most people would agree need to be seen on a big screen, in a movie theater. And yet, The Gray Man goes out to roughly 200 countries. RRR was sort of had a new lease of life when it dropped on Netflix. The idea of what a film is that in this sort of climate, perhaps in this world now, been redefined then?
I think it's evolving. Yeah. I mean, I would argue that it's evolving dramatically. And I think, the way that, I won't speak for Raja, but I will say that I know that the way that we think, that the two-hour closed narrative is a well-tread narrative. It's a form that is very difficult to see, reinvention. It's very difficult to surprise people with the two-hour closed narrative. That's how we feel anyways, which is why we're more interested in long-form storytelling. It can be more surprising. It's just really a amount of time that the audience spends watching something. So you kill a character after they spent an hour watching a movie, it has a certain impact on them. They watch 8 hours of a story and then you kill the character, it has an even more dramatic impact on them. So there is there's more potential in our mind for revolutionary storytelling in long form, which is why we encourage it and push it, which is what we all call universe building. But for us, all that means is a longer narrative than just a two-hour closed story. And that to us is where we're most compelled to go as storytellers. And I'm sorry, Raja, didn't mean to jump in, but I'd love to hear your point of view on this.
Absolutely. I absolutely agree with you. Just add to that, see, every storyteller, when he narrates a story, he wants his story to be heard by a larger number of audience. And he will be very greedy in that aspect. He needs more and more audiences to listen to his story. And there is no way we can have that kind of reach without digital distribution, Netflix being at the forefront of it, without having those kind of partners. We can't even imagine. I mean, the kind of reception RRR is getting now, we can't even imagine without Netflix taking it to so many countries, so many varied cultures, so many people speaking different languages. Being said that, again, my first love is always cinema. That is where I discovered my love for storytelling. And there is a kind of scare in my fear in my heart that digital distribution might completely eat away the cinema. That's a scare. I know it is not truth. Eventually they will settle down. There will be a cinemas will be a kind of film viewing experience. Digital distribution will be a different kind. Television will be a different kind of viewing experience. I think three of them will coexist, but the scare and fear is there.
I'll say this. I think to your point about it sort of settling down at one point, I think indie is a great proof that the theatrical experience will always be a wholly unique version of film going and distinct from streaming, because the energy that you get within the movie theater is just like nothing else that you can experience on your own or in a smaller home environment. And that's something that we sort of love as well, that collective experience when you're sitting in a theater together, you're feeling one another's energy, and you go on the ride with a whole theater full of people. That's another experience altogether.
You know, Mr. Rajamouli, I have to ask you, the abiding love for the big screen movie and you know, the big screen entertainment aside, has just the experience that you've had with RRR since it dropped on Netflix, is that tempting you in any way to perhaps do something straight for streaming?
I have some of the ideas which I have been contemplating to take for streaming, irrespective of the success of RRR. I mean, for a long time, for example, the Ponniyin Selvan, which Mandarathnam sir is doing now, for a long time I had that in my mind to make it for streaming, because that is the perfect way to tell that particular story. You can't tell that story easily in a film, but if you have a web series kind of thing where it is like, now you can tell the story in 8 hours or 10 hours or 15 hours or 20 hours, there are many stories that we have which a web series is a right platform, like Joe was explaining a bit earlier. I have a few of the thoughts like that, and that has got nothing to do with the success of RRR. I always had that thought.
You know, taking off from what Mr. Rajamouli said, I have to ask all of you, can you talk about what cinema meant to you growing up? Was it a big influence? And what were the films that changed your lives?
Big, big, big influence, films. For me, as a very young boy, Telugu films that I have watched, particularly from Vijaya Production House, Maya Bazaar, Misama, those are the classics of Telugu cinema. They had a huge impact on me. A little later, films like Ben-Hur, even today, I have said that so many times. I think I told you itself so many times that I have watched it like hundreds of times. I mean, just the Chariot Race, I would have watched. Chariot Race, I would have watched 1,000 times. And Braveheart, Mel Gibson is my favorite director. I get inspired so much from his real storytelling. All his films had a big impact on me. I can go on and on about the number of films that that had impact on me. Sure. Even today, even till date. Wow. Okay.
For us, yeah. I mean, films were very important to us when we were young, but so were music was very important. We were sort of into the arts in general and very much into pop culture, all forms, television, like I said, music. But movies were central, and we loved everything. We had a big appetite. We would watch sort of popcorn filmmaking, you know, that all your friends and family were watching, and you can enjoy that together. But we were also into more obscure movies as well. We grew up near a Cinematheque in Cleveland that had a great program of art cinema and global cinema. So we got exposed to a lot of films that weren't sort of playing for the mainstream or playing widely. So, at the end of the day, while we would geek out on a lot of obscure stuff, we were very much into the French New Wave and Francois Truffaut, but at the end of the day, it was those movies that everybody else was watching. Right. It seemed to be the most fun and energizing because you could connect to other people through the movies. And so the bigger sort of Star Wars and Indiana Jones and the bigger sort of Hollywood commercial adventure films were big touchstones for us as well.
You know, I have to ask the film geek question. What are you like when you're on the set? Are you patient? Are you anxious? Are you just raring to go? What is the temperament like when you're on set?
We prep diligently because we're a duo, so we have to collaborate. We have to talk through our process exhaustively before we get to set. But we have a crew, too, that we've worked with for many years that is part of that process now as well. So our development process is very disciplined but efficient. So when we're on set, we're executing as efficiently as possible. It's hard. It's long hours on set. People are away from their families. So we like to be respectful of their time and be decisive. But we like to keep it very light. There's lots of jokes. Expectations are for a level of professionalism, again, that is respectful. Our mood, though, is generally very light and easygoing geared towards problem solving.
Mr. Rajamouli, what do you like?
I so wish I could be like them. I'm very, very patient with the actors because I can't upset them, and because ultimately the audiences are going to see their faces. Their faces have to be the way they should be. So I can't get upset with them. I be very, very patient with them. But I blow my top off with the rest of the unit.
It is frustrating, that's for sure.
I want to end by asking all three of you, what is the last thing that you saw that made you go, wow, I wish I'd made that?
I just finished Stranger Things season 4, and I thought that the scale, and again, I don't want to get into a long conversation about long form storytelling versus 2-hour closed, but the scale of it was as big as anything I've seen. It had an ensemble that I cared about, mm-hmm. all the characters, and a villain that was frightening.
Right.
And I thought, that the Duffer Brothers had really ascended to the ranks of, you know, biggest filmmakers in the world with that season. I'm just more compelled by, that sort of robust storytelling. I also quite liked The Boys season 3 for the same reason. Scale, ensemble, thematics that were really powerful. And I tend to find that I'm more compelled by longer form pieces than so in general. I think I just respond more to shows than I do to movies now.
You know, this isn't the latest thing, but it just popped into my head when you asked the question, because mm-hmm. it was such a resonant thing for me. I remember when we saw the original Iron Man movie, the first Iron Man movie, for the first time. And you know, I think we can forget about this a lot because there ended up being so many sort of good films in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But that original Iron Man movie was mind-blowing. The way they combined spectacle and character, and the way they sort of inverted the approach to the superhero in that movie, it was just, never seen anything like that before, and it seemed so tonally modern that I remember having that feeling of wow. They got that. I wish we could have done that.
For you, Mr. Rajamouli?
Not in the recent past, like Anthony was saying. One of the films was Bajrangi Bhaijaan. I could have directed it if I had applied a little bit mind. I could have blocked the story for myself, but I didn't. I regret that. And not a film, but I used to play a game called Prince of Persia. I was really addicted to that game 15 years back, something 12, 15 years back. I really, really thought it would be very nice to make that character, write a story about that character and make it to a movie. I really thought that later Disney made it. Those two I wish I could have made.
Who knows, a reboot maybe on the cards. Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Rajamouli. Thank you to Joe and Anthony. This was really every film geek's dream. Thank you so much. This was
so
enjoyable.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Amazing
you.
Questions. And Raja, such a pleasure. Huge
yeah.
fan
thank,
again.
Thank you. So nice to meet you. But we should catch up. We should really yes. catch up. We'd yeah. like to meet.
We look forward to that. Thank you. And thank you for putting us together in this and for all your questions.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.